Good evening, ladies and gentlemen. A warm welcome on behalf of V Citizen Action Network and our Brihan Mumbai Municipal Corporation to a very special social sanchar on a special day. This evening, we are meeting exactly 5 years down the line. In 2014, when we started our social sanchar series, it was on 27th of November. And for the first time, our municipal commissioner, any municipal commissioner for that matter, is interacting in such an open forum, both with our in-house audience and our online participants. I'm Indrani Malkani. I am joined by my fellow trustee, Mr. V. Ranganathan, who was the former municipal commissioner and also demitted office as chief secretary of Maharashtra State. But here's a little history. Mr. Pardeshi, I started all this work with Mr. Ranganathan, and it's very fortunate that two municipal commissioners are sitting, in a manner of speaking, to interact with all of us. A quick word about VCAN. V Citizen Action Network is a not-for-profit registered trust. We have five trustees. I'm joined by Mr. Rajan Jaikar, Captain Saurabh Kapadia, and Captain Ashok Malkani, trustees of VCAN, along with me. Our primary objective is citizens connect and engagement with the statutory authorities, building bridges. We have to be able to work in partnership, and that's the spirit we work in and believe in that philosophy. About our municipal corporation, we really don't need to give a great introduction. Suffice to say, we are connected with a municipality from the time we are born till the time we die. Birth certificate to death certificate and everything in between. So a big hand for our municipal corporation. May I have the pleasure now of thanking our partners, our founding partner of our web portal, which we started in 2014, August, Eureka Forbes Limited, our venue partner for the social sanchars, which, as I mentioned a moment ago, started in November of 2014. The trust, of course, is much older, but these are the two highlights that I wanted to share. The venue partner for the social sanchar is our beautiful club, Royal Bombay Yacht Club. And our support partner for this social sanchar is Marathon Realty. Our college partner, our biggest strength lies in the young citizens of Mumbai, so the Jai Hind College, who are represented by their students. Our technical, our IT partner, Technolegion, and our video tech partner, whose technology powers the social sanchar, and also the organization which handles our social media, April Broadcast Limited. We owe our gratitude to our networking partners and all friends. We work together, an open platform, and we interact on various subjects. The format of the social sanchar, I will share after Mr. Pardeshi's introduction. Mr. Ranganathan, may I please invite you to introduce our guest speaker. Thank you.
Personally delighted to introduce Mr. Praveen Singh Pardeshi, whom I have has been a colleague for almost 15 years. He is an IAS officer of the 1985 batch. He has held many distinguished assignments. He was district collector at Latur, district collector at Solapur, municipal commissioner of Pimpri Chinchwad Corporation, Pune Municipal Corporation, and now, of course, Municipal Corporation of Greater Mumbai. And he did outstanding work as district collector Latur after the Killari earthquake, which devastated that, is an enormous program of rehabilitation and relief work. More than 30 villages had to be totally reconstructed. More than 100,000 houses had been constructed. And all this was accomplish in an exemplary manner in a very short period of time. This attracted the attention of the United Nations, and he was given a senior position in the United Nations Geneva, and for 7 years he was looking after the matters such as post-conflict rehabilitation, then disaster prevention methodology, and so on. Now, coming back to the state of Maharashtra, before he became the municipal commissioner, he was the additional chief secretary to the chief minister, and a number of initiatives had been taken by him in ease of doing business, simplifying rules and regulations, removing unwanted requirements, and having a system whereby a citizen can directly access and online get his work done in an automatic manner. So this is something which I think is really the need of the hour. Now, we look forward to a lot of expectations from him as Municipal Commissioner of Mumbai. I'll only mention one issue: citizens' participation in the government. Around 2000, two mechanisms were developed in BMC. One was the Advanced Locality Management, ALM scheme, in which citizens' groups were expected to participate in the running of the city. Now, at that time, I remember the instructions issued, the mandate of the citizens' group was quite extensive. They were supposed to report on the conditions of the road, footpaths. They were supposed to take care of the report about encroachments, water drainage issues, issues relating to feedback on BMC's plans and projects, beautification, greening, gardens, public amenities, environmental pollution, and rainwater harvesting, and so on. So a lot of expectations were there, where the citizens group will jointly work with the municipal corporation for officers for improving the city. The second initiative was the Dattak Basti Yojana. This was primarily aimed at the slums, where the conditions of sanitation and hygiene are quite miserable, and they were supposed to help in the management of these systems. So over a period of time, I find the implementation of these programs have been lackadaisical. We look forward to hearing from him on this and other issues. With these words, I extend a very warm welcome to Mr. Pardeshi, and we look forward to fruitful discussions. Thank you.
Thank you, Mr. Ranganathan. The format of the social sanchar, in continuation of what I was saying earlier, Mr. Pardeshi will share his opening statements and whatever else that he wishes to share with all of us this evening. Thereafter, we will open up for maximum time of the interaction, both from our audience in-house and from the online. One of the things I wanted to highlight at this point is that by the term that we have used, Citizens Connect, BMC Citizens Connect, the role and responsibilities of citizens and the officers, on the other hand, of how to engage with the citizens and get the maximum cooperation. I think this is one, the challenge both ways, and we look to seeing how in the spirit of partnership we can take it forward. We have received multiple questions which we will take up later, but before that, let us hear from our guest speaker, Mr. Pardeshi. Please take it forward. Thank you.
Initiative where we can citizens connect. And I always believe in that great statement of Paul Coelho that if we believe in our dreams, the universe conspires to make them come true. And this is the universe, and the municipal corporation is the agency which we can all make it happen as BMC of my dreams. So the first next few. Is it clearer now? You can use that. That is better.
Is the mic? Is there an issue with the audio?
No, I think they can hear it clearly, but in the room, it's not very clear. Still not clear, no? Okay, maybe I'll put it up. So I think in the opening, I just said that it's a great initiative. We can, and I mean, Mumbai is a city of everybody's dreams. And all of us can make it come true if we believe and we hope the universe conspires. One of the biggest elements of the universe is our my BMC. The way I had planned to talk to you today is to, I went through a lot of your Twitter comments, and a lot of the issues are recurrent, and of course they also basically formulate our vision of Mumbai. So I'll walk with you with some formal presentation, some knowledge of the initiatives that we are taking up, and then we'll just of course have an open discussion on that. So let's start with the very beginning. I don't know whether my works from here, or you have to make it work. Yeah. Okay. So this all we don't need to go for this. Things your very adage talks about better quality roads, about public transport, about greening, about water supply, about waste management, and the last few ones are basically citizens connect and going digital. And a lot of your issues are about unresolved complaints that you make but you don't hear back against them. So let me see if I can address some of those ones. So let's just put something, though we are all Mumbaikars, some very astonishing, you know, it's very interesting to look at things in a counterintuitive way. Things which appear to be true are not true, and things which are true, you don't know. So, for example, in Mumbai, we are a big city, the corporation is 475, not talking about population-wise, we all of us know we are gigantic, but even in terms of area, we have 475 square kilometers, that's huge. But you know, if you look at this area, 70% of the area is not where you and I, or most of us, live. So we live in 29% of the area. So the municipal corporation and all of you together, under the Maharashtra Regional Town Planning Act, prepare a development plan. And this development plan only sits on 142 square kilometers of the 4 cents. So where has all this huge area disappeared? So this whole huge area has disappeared primarily on, this is one big area where it's gone. Then it's here, the mangroves, and then of course in this Gorai and these other green areas. Together they constitute almost 2/3 of Mumbai geography, which is something which we don't get it. Though we are such a congested city, it's absolutely a wonder that we have so much of real wilderness. I'm not talking about the Central Park of New York type of park, which is man-cured, where people go cycling. There are birds in the thing, but there aren't leopards which kill real human beings. Because here the real ecosystem works. So that's a great thing for us. But you know, along with this comes a very huge issue for us. So when we all know the population of Mumbai, maybe it's 15 million now. So that's our population. Belong to one very big part of that population. Me, you, all of us. Can you just make one guess? Which part of Mumbai do we come from? All of us.
South Mumbai.
No. There might be somebody. Somebody's hearing. Yeah, I thought I'll use that.
Yes,
yeah. Can I, is this better?
So this
is, I think I'll switch off this because when the two go together. Can I switch off this?
Yeah, I think that you can leave.
So is this clear? Okay, perfect. And I hope you are also taken for your online. So I was just talking about that. I'll just, for what it is worth, let me see if I can go back to my. No. Can we go back to the earlier slide? Two slides? Yeah. That's perfect. So I was just mentioning that though we live in such a small part of Mumbai, and this is very good because we have such genuinely large green spaces despite all the cry and shouting of environmentalists about tree cutting and all of that, which are all genuine issues. No other city can boast of wild leopards genuinely living off their natural ecosystem next to human beings in the way that Mumbai can. So that's a great plus, and it's a huge plus to people who allow such a coexistence to take place. But along with it comes this big issue. I was just telling that we are 15 million of us, and of those 15 million, those of us who are in this room and those of us who are hearing this talk now belong to only one part of Mumbai. And that's where half of our issues lie. Can I just make one guess, because it's important for us to think this through. So we were on that question. Half of us only belong to that category. No? Where do we live?
South.
Huh? No, not south. There are people from North Mumbai anywhere. The whole of Mumbai.
Concrete.
They're just living in a house. Half of Mumbai lives in slums, which don't have any permissions. Exactly half, 70 lakhs. And for them, it's important that we have. So for them, it's important that we have a concept of housing for all. The previous slide shows you that, wherever we have the brown patches are where the slums are, and a lot of the slums are concentrated in exactly the areas which we leave green, because when our city plans good housing for people who have work and jobs and transport for us, we forget about the cheap housing for our drivers, for those who sell vegetables on the streets, and it's gone up. Yeah, and they also provide a lot of services, but they need to live in places which are not planned or affordable for them, and that's why the slums have come up. So the way we are trying to solve this is the first big issue. We are trying to, this whole program of housing for all, I mean, government has done many things, something which we all don't always agree with, but it comes with practical adjustment to what we are. We thought about 1995 as the cutoff date where all slum dwellers could be provided housing. It became 2000. Now, under the new government, it became right up to 2011 to be provided in situ housing. But how can you have in situ housing on green areas? Because most of the free lands is where people encroached and lived on. There are hillsides, there are creeks, there are sea beaches. So okay, then we came up with something called densification of in-situ, where we can go up to 4 but free up some area. It's not the first best solution, but the second best solution to at least intensify houses, because then they get sewage connections. So the sewage doesn't go raw in the sea, and they get drinking water and waste management, but at the time some area gets freed up. This plus the dilapidated buildings. Mumbai also inherits another big problem, which comes from its very good history that we developed lands in a planned way, we assigned properties to people who didn't have houses, tenants were protected. All of these good social laws have now come to, in a sense, have locked us into certain positions which we are finding difficult to unlock. For example, the reason why a building becomes dilapidated is not because its owner wants it to be dilapidated, not because the tenant wants it to be dilapidated, but because first we made tenants 100% secure, you can't displace them, which is very good. Then secondly, we said the tenancy can't be raised. Thirdly, the landlord cannot improve or change without the tenant's consent. So each one is at cross purposes with the other, and the building dilapidates and falls, and then we feel, oh, what are we doing about it? But nobody is willing to look at some of these so-called pro-poor laws, but which have caused this huge problem of buildings and deteriorating cities' infrastructure in these areas. So that's the second area that we are trying to work on through the new development plan, where we are saying that such dilapidated buildings are now all classified as C1, C2, then we can give them some additional buildability, But that still is not sufficient for the types of road bits that are there. So we are now forcing them to do clusters, but which also requires transit camps to relocate these people for the time being till the new buildings get built with new norms. So these are the two big steps if we want to ensure people who are not living as well as us in formal houses get houses which are with all civic amenities. The third big thing about us is streets. So if we look at the island city of Mumbai, and there is, if you take 269 square meters of it, we find that Mumbai has only 11% area under streets. So I was just reading Chikar Kariyaji's article today about pedestrians. So of course, pedestrians have it very bad, but you know, we are a very congested city, all that. And we are all adding to our private vehicles. I'm going to come to that. But despite all of that, this area has only 11% area under streets. Is this unusual? So that's what New York does. New York, if any of you have gone to New York, very congested city, huge buildings. But you know, it puts aside 33% area under streets. Now, why is this important? It's important because I'll open it up to all of you. Are streets only streets? Streets are something more than streets. Of course, you talked about them being places for social interaction, at least the pedestrian path. That's one, but that's still visible. I'm talking about something literally deeper.
Hawkers.
Hawkers, yes. That's again visible on the surface. I'm talking about something deeper.
The pipeline.
Exactly. Just like our human body is not what we see from the top, we see eye, my skin, my thing, but that's not at all the human body. Human body is what runs on inside. The organs of the city, when you stand in your bathroom in the morning and just touch on the tap, presto, the water comes. The water is coming from 400 kilometers away. Where are the pipelines coming? The pipelines, 6,000 kilometers, which is from here to London, all run under the streets, but that's just water. What happens when we use the water and we flush down, and our bathroom is very clean, isn't it? All that water also goes under the streets. But these are just two things which we carried over from the past, and therefore the island city was reasonably well planned. The British thought a lot about these two things. But between then and now, there are at least 10 other new things that we do under the streets. One more guess. Electricity and OFC cables. OFC cables and gas lines. Now let's assume this yacht club is there and it's a public space and I want to supply cooking gas to the next door hotel. So though it's a public space, would you allow me to sort of demolish this right in the middle and just take the... No. So where do I use the space from? From under the street. And of that we have only 11% in Mumbai. And why do we have 11%? So let's understand that. That's because a lot of us, because we are so well, so much privileged, have the second class AC. We are reserved compartment. Everybody else outside. Attitude. Sorry, I'm being a bit dizzy. So it works because of that. So look at this. This is about Indian cities. And this is not my fact. This is Dr. Bimal Patel. So you will see that under buildings in Mumbai, only 20 to 28% of the area of Mumbai city is under buildings. That's not much. But roughly 50% of their area is locked under private open spaces. And that's the desert. So the same thing done in New York is the building footprint. They utilize every piece of land very, very usefully. They don't have anybody or hardly anybody living in slums because they put 50% of their city under buildings. If you put 20% of the land under buildings, then you expect half of your population to live in slums because they can't go anywhere else. So New York builds very densely for use value, so 50%. But if they do that, then they must be having narrow streets and no public spaces. So their public spaces, streets for example, are twice or three times as much as we have. So what they cut down is private open spaces. And why do private open spaces come into our planning norms? We want that open space out there to do and put our cars. We can't have buildings next to each other. So all of these norms which came from the past, and if you want to change any of them, there's a huge group of people who go and agitate. It was tried in the previous work plan, and a lot of interested people came and shut down all those provisions. Because we want to keep all our current buildings in the same amount of dignity as we want. So there's a trade-off involved here. That's all I'll say. I won't comment further on that. And then I'll end with this controversial story about the coastal road. So we just thought we're sitting in this yacht club, and I'm sure none of us can say that because this island city has only 11% under road. So just to double that 20%, we need a big thoroughfare. Let's cut it in the middle and go through it. But this is just still a public body. Imagine if that happens to the building in which you are staying. And we know that we need to do that if you want to even double the streets. And not streets for more public transport, streets for more direct gas connection. We can't do all of that now that Mumbai is already built up. So that's why the coastal road comes. The coastal road is the only additionality of public space which cuts across the whole of Mumbai. Okay, then India might be a country which is really charted an uncharted walk by making this thing. But every single country which is on the coast, especially countries which are below, are filling up the sea with such rapidity that more than for the, let's assume that we don't even want this road for the coastal road. Let's say it's all wrong, it's meant for elite car owners, which it is not. Just for the fact that to keep our Mumbai sea line where it is, you need to build outwards. Why? If anyone of you have been to Dubai? Been to Dubai. Anybody been to Singapore? And Netherlands?
Yes.
Okay. So these three places, what they were 100 years ago, they're not now. They have expanded into the open ocean by as much as their original landmass. Dubai, for example, if you fly over. Now, this is the sea in between. The sea is connected to India. If all these countries are filling up their sea, where is the water coming? What's happening to the water level touching Mumbai? So all of these, I'm sorry, I'm using very strong words, harebrained ideas. That by doing a coastal landfill, we are A, enhancing climate change. My dearest friends, that's the only one, but along with protecting mangroves, this is the only way locally we can safeguard. I mean, to safeguard against climate change, we need to mitigate greenhouse gas emissions, which is a long-term issue, but we'll come to that, how we can do it. But short of that, let's say we don't do all of that, but we need to protect ourselves. Of course, you need to protect the sea level rise against it. The coastal road is doing exactly that. So this blind opposition to the coastal road is something quite interesting, and which comes to be an important issue on VCAN, which is that, you know, you talked about BMC. Thanks about that. Again, what is BMC? BMC is your BMC. What all you make of it? You elect the representatives. You pay the money, you can govern them, and you can control them through hundreds of other measures. So if we cannot have one team which includes BMC and yourselves, we are never going to work. And every single thing, it's not shortage of funds for BMC. As Mr. Ranganathan was saying, it's not shortage of capacity. It's shortage of not being on the same team. That's all. You'll get a BMC of your dreams if you begin to trust each other more. This being just one example, how much it delays this project. See, finally, the Supreme Court will set aside all those, just like they did to Narmada project and all, and this road will be built. But it will be built 10 years later. And each day, 4 crores, which none of us, I mean, neither the petitioners are paying, nor anybody. All of you are paying by higher cost and money. So we need to sort of fold ourselves once into this and say that, look, we take collective decisions. Collective decisions involve trade-offs. People living opposite Pardeshi Park, whose views get disturbed because of the coastal road, of course are suffering. But let's look at that suffering versus the sorts of problems it solves. And then city as a whole, we have to take a trade-off decision on this. I come to roads, it's a very sensitive issue about all of you. And, you know, we had that song from Malishka and so many others about Mumbai, Haddad Gili, whatever. And of course it's true. So we did feel a lot of concern. And that's an area where we thought we can involve citizens a lot. We have this app, My Fixit app, where we can report it. And we really made it work. And, you know, the thing is, I can say I made it work. People say, no, it's just a farce. So that's why we put the 500 rupees out. We said that whether we fixed it or not, you decide. And so a lot of people came, but a lot of people said that we don't want even the money. You did fix it. And those comments are there, out there on the Twitter. In fact, a lot of other cities like Hyderabad, Thane, and more important, Bangalore, took up this, the same challenges and started it on that way. We also did a third-party rating for the response from it, which is something like 65% of the respondents did say that their work or their complaints got addressed. But this again is not at all a solution to the problem. So like potholes are, and fixing the potholes is absolutely very, very superficial, just say that. It's neither the problem is correct, that is, roads having potholes is not even a definition of the problem. And filling up the potholes so that the road is smooth is not even the solution. So that's where I'm coming from. So we look very deeply into why we have roads which recurrently are getting potholes. So of course, one standard reply is, yes, there's corruption. A lot of money gets wiped out in the corruption. So if that was the one way to stop it, then I can tell you with a lot of confidence that that's not even the main reason. That doesn't mean that there is no corruption. What I'm saying is we need all measures to stop whatever corruption there is. But that's not the reason why the roads have potholes. So then what is? Quite simply, because the roads are looked upon simply as surfaces where cars travel. They are not that. As we just started by saying, most important thing that roads are they are places from where the storm water, that is the heavy rain of Mumbai, gets drained off into sufficient capacity storm water drains which can go right up to the sea. This is a very complicated system. The British devised it for 25 millimeters rainfall per hour discharge. Today, in the highest times, we get more than 100 millimeters per hour rainfall. That time when the water flows on the road, then the roads can't take it anymore. But that's just one thing. The second thing is all these new utilities that we decided to have as the city grew, from gas pipelines, telephone, OFC cables, they are all ad hoc put on. And we need them also. We need the internet, we need all of that. So all these were put up on the site, but when they get to be repaired, then we have to dig up the roads, and that digging up and reinstatement, however well we do, weaken the roads forever. So what we are doing now, and this is the real thing, this is the thing which you won't see, but that's where the solution lies. We are re-engineering all the roads, all the roads, all this. These are the JS network map where all the potholes through the My Fixit pothole app we have mapped. And all of these roads are going to be re-engineered by providing the utilities to be shifted to the sites, which costs as much as building the new road. And also by having the stormwater drainage of the expanded capacity from 55 to additional millimeters rainfall, because that's what we are expecting. And that's when we get through with this. I'm sure that some of the roads will start being roads without potholes. And this is some of the work that we are doing. We're also adding some new technologies like the cement grouted bituminous mix, which is much easier to do and can make the roads pothole free. So from roads, I want to come to something about climate change and greening Mumbai. First, the good news about Mumbai, just because I said that so much of Mumbai is no development zone. So if you look at the number of trees in New York, it's only 6.6 lakhs. And Tokyo does even worse, little better, but 19.2. And London is one of the best, there's a lot of parks, 80 lakhs. But here, presto, Mumbai is somewhere here. And there is a slight statistical problem with this figure, because 55 lakh of these trees come from this area, which is Sanjay Gandhi National Park. So maybe this figure is not right. So we looked at something else. We looked at trees per square kilometer. So this is where New York is, this is where Tokyo is, And this is where London is, does very well. But despite subtracting the 55 lakh trees, Mumbai still has 7,800 trees per square meter. It's very good news for all of us. So we should be living in a very clean and polluted city. But we shouldn't clap so soon. We are very, very badly off in something which is different. So, if we have more trees, we live in a green place. We should have be living in a very pollution-free city. But that's not the case. And so, if you see this, all these cities, you know, all the first world cities, the New York, Londons of the world, their particulate matter pollution is well within the norms below 10-15. And the middle income countries come somewhere in between. But this is where Mumbai figures at the top. It's one of the most polluted cities. Only Beijing does more than us. So sad that despite all the trees, we couldn't address this problem. And this directly affects all 15 million of us. So where is this coming from? So this is coming from the huge growth, what you talked about in the article on the footpaths and the pedestrians, is coming from the personal vehicles. By the way, this is nothing to be very scared of. During my UN stint, I've been to all the countries around us, surroundings, Jakarta, all of these. They all went through the same phase. You can remember Mumbai of 70s, where the streets were very good. And then suddenly by 90s, all the streets got lost. Because suddenly with economic growth came private wealth. With private wealth came a lot of private vehicles. And with the private vehicles came this particulate pollution, which is so heavy that a lot of us are getting higher incidence of both tuberculosis, including cancer. So what do we do with this? So one way to think about it laterally is maybe London has far less vehicles. Maybe it has got far poorer people, or Tokyo. But we all know their per capita incomes are 8 to 9 times above us, and so is their wealth. So how come London manages to maintain such good clean air, having even less trees than we have compared to Mumbai? And here's the answer: public transport. Everybody in London or Tokyo or New York, in the core of the city, moves around in public transport. Whether you are an executive or whether you are some office clerk, you all move in the same public transport. And that's one area where, just like our municipal hospitals are supposed to be meant for the poor, municipal schools are meant for the poor, the public transport is meant for those who can't afford cars. That's wrong. So that's what first thing that we are trying to change. Because whether it is pollution, whether it is climate change, sorry, I'm trying to be provocative, but then you can ask more questions. Planting more trees doesn't help you to counter climate change in Mumbai. I'm talking about Mumbai as a whole. Yes, across India it does, but not for Mumbai. In Mumbai, we can do far more to counter climate change if we can shift the passenger burden from the current 35-40%, wherever it is, to 60-80% on public transport. Just by this one step, we can do far more to mitigate climate change than and of course get cleaner air and cancer-free lives in Mumbai. So what are we doing for that? In BEST, we have reduced the fares to 5 rupees. And you know, here presto, we got the figures to go up, and it's going up further. But that's the visible part. The hidden part is, and that's more important for me, BEST is making a huge loss. And the huge loss is because the buses which are owned by BEST also have BEST employees, that is bus drivers, and they all get and are unionized and get very heavy salaries and all the dues. And anybody who's entrenched in as a group who have facilities can't be shifted very easily. So what we have done, all the new fleet is coming as a private fleet. And that part I had to negotiate with the unions. Otherwise, they're every time going on a strike. So all of these stops were provided so that today we have an agreement, including with the union, that all the new buses are private franchisee buses, all these new air-conditioned buses, and their costs are sometimes 20% less per kilometer than the cost of best run bus, not because there is a difference, but because their salaries are lesser, their maintenance costs are much lesser, and they're more efficient overheads by. So that private wet leasing of buses is the second big thing. All the new fleet, we have got 3,500 buses roughly, we are going to 6,000 buses, all the new buses are coming as private wet leases, which are more efficient, and therefore causing less losses per kilometer of travel. The third thing which I all want you to use, if any one of you use best, thank you, thanks. So, no, but I want to ask this question to you. So, on this we are like London, we are like New York. Every single best bus now is GPS enabled. Do you know that?
Yes.
Secondly, on your telephone, you can download an app called Best Pravas, where you can see the bus, which bus, if you're waiting for bus number 7 or 10 or whatever, you can see when it's coming to you, how late it is. You can enter your destination on the bus and it will tell you, predict the time it's going there. I want you to use more of it. This is the first few months of its application. It's still got lots of small bugs. But you need to use it, you need to complain, you need to make us aware, because what I want is in the next 2 to 3 months of this 30 lakh passengers who are using best, at least 25 to 30 lakh passengers should be, today only 60,000 are using this app. So this will also make us more accountable, because once we start getting complaints about the buses being late, then we can find out where it was traffic, where it was other things. Okay, I'll come to something else which all of you are very, some of you are very concerned about. This huge 10,000 rupees fine on people for parking. Now what has that got to do with climate change? What has that got to do with absence of 11% space under roads? And what has that got to do with bus fares coming down to 5 rupees? So what people tell us, oh, we don't mind travelling in bus and not even mind paying 20 rupees for our fare. But the bus doesn't move. It doesn't reach any spot on time. And why doesn't it move? Because all of us, lot of us, own, I started by saying that we own houses. And we also take ownership of one more thing, the roads. Mobility is not ownership. At least that's a public usage. The moment you park your car on a public road, which is paid for from a slum dweller's slum cess, who doesn't own a car, we know at least 70% people who don't own cars in Mumbai, they're never going to occupy a road with their car. But we make him pay for building the road, but we want to use the road privately. It's not fair. And it's because we don't have the provision for congestion fees, so we are doing this to ensure that at least the public buses can travel faster. It's making a difference on many parts. We come to gardens. Gardens are something which all of you love, but we are trying to shift the policy to make gardens having more Meraki. Meraki is a word where, you know, you can manage a thing with a bit of your soul. Right now we are managing these gardens through a policy which I don't agree with, should be contract managed. All our gardens are now being managed. We took them away from people whose hearts and souls were in the garden, some Bandra association, some, you know, this, lots of these local associations who were managing these gardens, because we thought, oh, they are going to capture these gardens and make them their own. But my philosophy is totally different. I said, if they own those gardens within the mind, ownership, and they love those gardens, they maintain them with love and care, we want to have them. Yes, there are some problems of elite capture. We can stop it by having a ward level committee which includes ALMs to co-manage these spaces, but they can collect some fees for special events from these gardens and recycle the money back into maintaining the gardens in the way in which they feel, because it's their local garden, it's their local space. So that's the new policy which we are now proposing to the GB. About plantations, you know, all this talk about planting trees here, there, you know, I love trees, I'm a wildlifer personally, but it doesn't work out that much now because of the number of people and housing that we are living. So we are going in for something called Miyawaki plantation, which is basically a Japanese invention, only indigenous species, only Indian trees. Its name is Miyawaki, nothing to do with Japan in that way. We don't even plant gulmohrs because it's exotic. The rain tree, which all of us see lots, is purely exotic tree. Don't plant them. Only plant trees which grow in Sanjay Gandhi National Park in the local climate, but very densely by making the subsoil strata very organic in content. And some of these steps now, our ward offices are opening up to all of you. I'll now come to water supply. I have a couple of minutes more. Yeah. So, you know, our water comes from all the way from Tansa, 400 kilometers away, and we get really cheap water because it's up in the mountains and it comes almost free to us. What we are working on the water is, because the residential water is so subsidized, it's at 5 rupees and 90% of us are residential users, but our water supply still runs in some profit because the industrial users or the commercial users, we charge 35 rupees. So what we are now doing is, we are doing two big things. One is, we are now treating all our wastewater so that we can make our seas blue. And that's a huge project. Right now, all our sewage is going at 200 BOD, which is almost fecal matter, into the sea. So most of our sea is nothing but raw fecal matter of our 15 million citizens flowing out there. So in the next 5 years, all the projects have been started now, all. But it takes 3 to 5 years to maintain that. But after treating the water, we are going to recycle it back for non-potable use, which is at least for gardening and for flushing of toilets. And for that, we are insisting on separate pipelines for the newer buildings. So this is regarding water, this is regarding sewage, I told you. And with waste, you know, just go back to the earlier slide, sorry. Yeah. So Marathon is one great society which has zero discharge. I don't mean segregation. We got caught on segregation. This is where we involve the ALMs. The segregation is important, but unless we can dispose of this directly to waste users at the society level, we won't create value. So we are giving a tax incentive for this up to 10% if you are able to dispose of your waste directly. The flooding issue is an issue which comes up every year. You know, we know the geographical reasons. We are like a small island. Whenever the high tide and high rainfall coincide, we get those areas flooded. We have this brimstone program where we are putting up huge pumps on the sea to pump out this water. But again, this is a stopgap arrangement. Every day during high rainfall, we pump out entire Virar Lake. And so, good enough, somebody said on our Twitter, now we are very active on Twitter, said, look at this foolish BMC pumping out entire fresh water of BMC. We were trying to take some credit for it by saying, oh, you know, this is the amount of water which would have been on your streets if we hadn't pumped them out from those red blocks, which are the new pumping stations which have come up. And here Presto came up with a very wise reply, what is this stupid BMC wasting so much water? So this is what we are doing now. Can we run this film?
Doors. This surge tank is the largest in the world, but even this massive structure is just the tail end of a flood control system that stretches an up.
So in Tokyo, they have the same problem. They have no space to take where the rivers are. So all the surplus water of the river flows in underground channels. They have 5 rivers and they face tsunami. They face climate change with the same ferocity as we face it. And they also know that even if a petitioner goes to court, says, this is the flood plains of the river, please keep it free. Tokyo cannot have any space left for floodplain because there are more than 20 million people living there. So they know all that. This is all just poetry. We need to do the real things. The last 5 years, they built up a program where every single amount of surplus water flows underground. Now, we have had an MOU with JICA, government of Japan, which we just did it. The people who designed this are Pacific consultants for Tokyo. They're working with us. Right now, my team is in Japan. And this will take maybe 5 to 7 years. But that's what it takes to be waiting for the climate change. The climate change is not going to happen just by saying the sea level will rise. The climate change prediction model for Mumbai is not simply the sea level rise. It's fewer rainy days, but more intense rain. So suppose we get 1,000 millimeters rainfall, but we used to get it in 60 days, we are going to get same 1,000 millimeters rainfall, but only in 20 days or in 10 days. Which means per day the rainfall is very high. So the per day, none of our rivers can carry it. So that's why Japan understood this. That's why the water has to be diverted into safe areas. That's what we are working on there. I think we don't have time to go over schools, so I won't get into schools. We are talking a lot about creating better learning outcomes and working with partners on that. So let me just think we're running out of time. And heritage is another area we are working. I'll just end with this issue about ALMs. So, you know, Mr. Malkani, Mr. Ranganathan, all of them told me that ALMs have become a little bit defunct. So we have, at least by circular, we have revived it. In the last meeting of all my ward officers, Mrs. Malkani attended. She gave a presentation about ALM, and a lot of our ward officers have started taking it. And we are just saying that ALMs are not there just for some discussion shop. They need to achieve concrete outcomes. So under the law, we gave them one very interesting authority. If a society claims that it is segregating and reusing all its waste, then they can get 5% property tax and the ALM can certify it, not the ward officer. Ward officer will be present, but we need an ALM certification. So this is like a third party, not its own society, but a society in that area. So that's one more authority that we have given, and some other decentralized powers that we are giving them for ensuring a check on. And that's leading to some sort of citizens' resolutions. For example, a lot of people in the questions that you all asked me, a lot of the complaints don't get addressed. Yes, it's true, a lot of your complaints don't get addressed. But in terms of numbers, it's stupendous. For example, we get 3,000 tweets, and that's the main reason why we didn't want to start a Twitter account. My predecessors didn't want to start it. But once we started it, we get something like 30 to 60,000 tweets. 3,000 are very forceful complaints. So of them, we are able to resolve 2,500. They are there on our Twitter. It's not that I'm claiming it. You can look at that. Similarly, we get something like 70,000 complaints on our 1916. About 67,000 of them are resolved. What I've started now is 10% of them are phoned back to ask whether they're satisfied. That percentage is still 50% only. That is, of the 10% who are phoned back, only 50% of them say, we are satisfied with your complaint resolution. So then I went into details of why are these were. So the pothole ones, that's not the issue. For the water not reaching, that's not the, they're okay. The area on which this 50% non-satisfied group is encroachments and people of the people on the pavements and all of this. So all of the unsatisfied ones, you remove them, they come back again. I'm not going to answer that question now because I know they are there in large numbers. So I'll take that question. Thank you.
Thank you very much, Mr. Pardeshi. I know the presentation has been long, but then municipality is so multifaceted. It's got so many things because it actually touches our lives, our everyday lives in every aspect. So there's nothing we can do. With your permission, maybe we could put up your presentation on our portal.
Yeah.
Yes. So we can go back. When we put up the report, we will give a link to the presentation so we can all go back and study it at length and understand it better. We, as Mr. Pardeshi just mentioned, that so many tweets come. But when we sent out the invitation of this evening's interaction, within, I think, 48 hours, we received more than 55 tweets. And we are tiny, but still we got all these. However, what we did was we took up some of the issues which maximum tweets came on, and we made a summary. So we will take up one of the tweets which is related to a particular issue. So as I was saying earlier, the format will be, we will take up in-house questions. But since the questions of tweet have come in so many, let us take some of the online questions which have also come on SMS. And of course, we will take in-house. Before taking up the first question, I must share, our municipal commissioner is one of a rare kind. He is a wildlife enthusiast and an environmentalist. Nobody wants to believe it, but that's a fact. I am told that during his probation time, or whenever that was, right, when you were under training, he used to disappear in the forest, keeping his other buddies wondering where he had disappeared. So we are very happy to have you as our commissioner now to resolve so many of these challenges that we talked about. So as you said about encroachments, I think a tweet has come in, which is removal of encroachments on footpaths. Can we have that tweet, please? So if some of you can't see it, yes.
Just to tell you, I have seen all your 55 tweets, not today, before. And I've already classified them in my mind. So as I told you, it's about encroachments. Mm-hmm. And I also told you that the encroachment issue doesn't get finally resolved. Encroachment issues by formal sector. That is, if you have a big building which is being built completely illegally, yes, it's easy to break it down. And that does happen to a great extent. It's not very easy to build 5,000 square meters up there. But these small people who hawk on the streets and all. So we did a whole survey of all the hawkers. And those who are claimants, forget about who have just mushroomed. This number is above 90 or 93,000 people who do all sorts of hawking. Under the new town vendor policy or a hawking policy, which is mandated by government, there are some norms by when they should have been in place and where they can hawk. For example, it shouldn't be at crossings of roads which cause pedestrian congestion. It shouldn't be on narrow streets which have no footpath, things like that, you know, where there is sufficient space. So based on that survey which went on for 2 to 3 years, I have approved about 19,000 of these 90,000 as which fit within all norms and for specific locations. But that doesn't solve the problem for the other 60,000 who are officially on our records. Now, that still doesn't include the other X number who are not fully accounted for. So one way is to be very brutal and say, tomorrow you don't exist, and I'm sure we can do that if you want to. But I'm not part of that, that I believe that we want to do any such thing. Because today, I mean, one of the things I did tell you about our development plan, one of the objectives of the development plan is Mumbai of my dreams, jobs. And jobs require space. And all the space we are using up to live in, where do we create the jobs? So in all the textile mills which created the jobs have now become half residential complexes, are becoming more residential, commercial complexes, because it's very difficult the way the real estate market works, that's an aside. We need to create spaces for hawking. So in our development plan, what we are trying to do is both with the cooperative societies, which are coming up afresh, by increasing the FSI on commercial spaces. For every builder, we are imposing a certain giveaway, amenity open space, which he has to surrender to us, where we are forcing this corner shopping type of things, which we are giving to people who are on the sides of road widening or these types. But unless we can take care of all of this, completely ruthlessly keeping aside all the places hawker free, is personally, I don't feel it's going to happen. And if it happens, it happens at very great cost. And the cost is not borne by me, it's borne by the poorest people who make the city run. So it's not going to, we can regulate it a bit more, which we are trying. Areas which really block traffic, areas which make footpaths not accessible to the railway stations, all those areas, we are incrementally going to make it more harsh. But rest of the places, it's still going to be, if we remove some, they'll still come back. Because that's the only place of work for the poorest people in the city.
It's a bit of a socio-economic problem, so that's the reason why these challenges come up. We could take one audience question. I know many hands will go up. So I have to go with our young friend here. I think the question he's going to ask. Yes, so wait, we'll have to give the mic here. A little bit about, is Ram Prasad going to ask the question?
He is Ram Prasad, and it is his question that I'm asking.
Okay.
He's actually written a letter to...
So, what would he like to ask the question?
Because I need to modify a bit, because he's answered a lot on
okay.
the history and
right.
Encroachment. The thing is that we consider employment and all these things. But something like there is a RA store. I have gone through the hawkers policy and they specify that 1 meter by 2 meters is the maximum space that they can occupy. But we see that on GV Somani Road where we are staying, it's more than 2 meters and
the RA stores. The RA stores.
RA stores. And it is in such a fashion that ideally 22 inches or 24 inches has to be spared so that people, person like him can go. Or ladies carrying perambulators, or maybe old people who are carrying walking sticks, they can go. But not just those RA stalls, but also because recently, I mean, in the last 6 months, there are also those roundels around the trees which have been made. So it further narrows down the whole thing. Instead of making those roundels, if the footpath was just
understood.
Repair, that
would
have been much better.
Mr. Pardeshi, I think I'll just put it in context a little, particularly the question coming from Ram Prasad. This talks about the accessibility part, particularly of people who are wheelchair bound, older people. So the space needed for maneuvering. So I think one of the designs of the footpath was also regarding the slope, right? So in that context, this question is put.
So very seriously to tell you, personally, I'm just talking personally, that doesn't mean Mumbai City has not done, but personally I have not really addressed the issue of pedestrian and footpath improvement. I'll tell you that in Pune, I had set up something totally separate, totally devoted to non-motorized transport, and I want to do it here. Only thing is that when I joined 6 months back, when your potholes and the floods was the main thing, so I was just focusing on that. Then came this whole issue about pothole and the road. So that, so still now that we want to have a dedicated thing to improving footpaths. Having roundels around trees, absolutely wrong. we want evolving a standardized design. We are working with this parking authority, with our organizations of local self-government to make footpaths really, really pedestrian friendly. And we're going to invest in that, put money for that. And that doesn't cost that much, and the benefits are a lot. Then the issue about making it, you know, accessible to all. So that part of the engineering, detailing the engineering of the ramps up and down.
Ma'am, you must use the mic.
Improve that. And the trees, there are better ways to look after the trees by having those iron, things where the water can go in without having these types of roundabouts. So all of that, not done. Hope we can do it.
Thank you. We go back to one of our SMS questions which we have received. If we can have it. So the question is, dear Mr. Commissioner, what
that
is my...
So yes. Anyway, it'd be good. I don't know which specific question there is. That's why I gave you the figures that on the Twitter, at least we monitor all the tweets. And wherever there is a resolvable complaint, if you look at our account, we are responding to it. In fact, one of the main reasons I agreed to come for your... I saw one comment from somebody who said that, yes, you're using Twitters to resolve complaints. Some Andheri association people have put that. So, I mean, I would like to know...
But we have to use digital platform in any case. Yeah. Yes, I know many hands are going up. Maybe have... Yes, please, at the back. 1 minute, please. I'm requesting the in-house audience not to speak till the mic reaches you, because everything gets broadcast, so please have the patience.
Yeah.
Yes, please.
What is BMC doing for the levels of dengue prevention?
You want me to stand up and speak? Yeah.
Yeah. So, what is BMC doing for dengue prevention?
So we have a very big vector prevention program, particularly it's active during rainy and the post-rainy season. So we do inspections of all the stored water areas. We also monitor the case histories in our hospitals. We get 21 lakh patients. If we know the origin from where that patient has come, then we send a team out to check out that area. Recently, near the Mantralaya area, the residential area had some dengue breeding spots. We could stop it. So it's basically, on one side, awareness. We know how to prevent dengue. All of us know it. I mean, more needs to be done about that awareness. And secondly, monitoring the patients who are suffering from dengue to find out where that source came and plugging it. Okay, so these are the two big things we're doing.
Yes, the mic may please come to this side now. But whilst the mic comes there, maybe also say that to a great extent, a big responsibility lies on us citizens as well to ensure that we do what we need to do. And I think people should also know that it's a notifiable disease, right? So it has to be informed to the municipality. Yes, please.
We're really lucky to have you. Firstly, someone who listens, pays attention, is an environmentalist. With that in mind, two things. One, you spoke about the quality of the air and what you are doing to promote public transportation. That's the only way out. But on the other hand, nature abhors a vacuum. And when you create a facility, it gets used. So when you create something like the coastal road, that will get used and that will lead to the increase in cars.
Yes.
So why are we putting money which we don't have into building the most expensive road in the history of mankind?
Yeah.
No road has been made which is so expensive. So it just seems contrary to what you're saying. If you want to improve the quality of the air, don't make roads. Spend your money here. That's one. So just why is that being done? And your argument about... it acting like a dam doesn't really work because there are bridges and the water will come through because you need the water to go out and water to come in. There are bridges on that for the fishermen to go out so that it's not blocked. So it's not a barrage. So with the sea level rises, that water is going to come in any case. And why is it only that 9.8 kilometers which is being built over here? The rest of it is on stilts. So the water is going to come in. So why is this 9.8 meter... going to solve the problem, and how is it going to solve the problem? So that doesn't make much sense to me. So that's one. The other is in your budget.
Shall we restrict it for one, please, because there's so many questions. Thank you so much.
No, but it's good that you asked the question. So the first thing is that we all know that even for public transport, the current road width in Mumbai, I started by saying it's 11%. No other city in the world, I mean any of the good cities that you go to, have 11%. Where will you make 11% 20%? If you give me that solution, huh? No, metro.
1 minute, with the mic, please.
Do you know how many petitions we are making metro? But did you know how many petitions we have from the Parsi Association, from all of them, that the metro is going close to their thing? Because with these types of road widths, where even for making metro, the type of multi-layered metro that exists in London or in New York, you don't have that sort of an underground public space. So we need to create public space which is owned by the city, not owned by individuals. So that's my first problem with that. So 11% to that increase, that's first. Secondly, it's not about cars alone. It's about buses. It's about BRT traffic, if you can have bus rapid transport. And then the other thing about the water going in or going out. So that wherever there are creeks, the water still comes in, even now. So the creek levels have to increase, but the water, which is the average increase in the sea, if we are saying that with temperature rise of 2 degrees, if the average level goes up by half a meter, or let's say 1 meter, then 1 meter would be across the coastline of Mumbai where it goes up. So, but the part where this rampart is there, that 1 meter doesn't go directly into your livable area. For the rest of the thing, you have to do more, of course. It doesn't go in there. It goes through the creeks. So, in the creeks, we have to do additional measures which we will treat with them. Hopefully, we are protecting the mangroves, which act as a good bulwark on most of our creeks. Now, coming to your figure about, like, most of the things which I did on the presentation are cross-referenced. So, I'd really like to know where the figure about it being the costliest road has come. We can do some cross comparison with it. When I told you about the tree numbers, they are all cross referenced with some report which you can look up. But I'd like to know by what logic it's the costliest road. We need to compare likes with likes. So when we have 19 or 20 hectare road and roughly about 40 hectares of garden landfill, what is the per unit cost of this? And if that is the cost list that, with this type of a sea topography, then we are doing something wrong, definitely. We need to compare it with that. So we are creating something like X hectares, I think roughly 60 or 70 hectares of garden and open public space, and about 19 hectares of road space purely in the sea. And we need to compare the cost of that with what is the most cost efficient on that. So that's where I am on that.
Thank you. Could we have an SMS question, please? It's just that we need to give much time to the online questions that have come in. The question, if you would like to, I think you can all see it on the screen.
I accept this, and I really, really take this seriously, that we are not maintaining footpaths to the standards that we are maintaining roads. Many of you don't agree that the roads are good, but still, the roads are being maintained much better than footpaths, and that variation is not acceptable. We need to reverse it. We need to maintain footpaths even better than the road. So that's some shift that we will do. You know, we have been too much in the emergency response sort of situation. Let's hope we can.
Thank you. I think there's a mic. Yes, please.
Thank you. Sir, it is again about footpath. The new redeveloped buildings, all BMC gives permission, they take their plinth level higher and all footpaths are made slope. The full width of the building is made a slope footpath. People cannot walk, number one. The trees on the patch of footpath goes away. Number two, number three, no car is allowed to park in front of that. So three big disadvantages. The first one is important. People cannot walk on that slope. Why you allow? Each and every redeveloped building has this problem, sir.
I'll look into it. I really don't know this issue.
I'll take note.
No, this issue about redevelopment buildings and sloping footpaths, I'll look into that. This is the first time I've heard about it. No, but I'll take note of it.
Thank you. There will be many, many questions. And the questions we will on pass to Mr. Pardeshi, and he will reply on Twitter, whichever the Twitter questions are, I think, or the others, if you may give us, we will publish it also. Yes, there's a lady who picked up the phone. Yes, please.
I have one question. We are in Juhu area, and most of the footpaths, as you said, are encroached, taken over, and the market is also there. most of us who live in that Juhu ISKCON area have to compulsorily walk on the road. There's no other way. Both the sides are very close. Now on top of that, the traffic commissioner has also cordoned off the area. So the traffic is jammed because there's ISKCON Mandir. Probably you know about it. We have complained to the traffic commissioner. Why can't you work in collaboration with the traffic police commissioner so that at least these roads are made one way, so the traffic moves on one side and we can at least walk.
No, we'll work on this.
It's possible to walk near that ISKCON area.
We'll work on your ISKCON thing, but more important, we'll see that why those footpaths are blocked. That those definitely specific footpaths we can really get cleared up permanently.
We have complained to
the but we'll do it now. We'll see some action on that.
So many times the cars hit us.
Yeah.
Because it's so narrow and it's divided.
The footpaths.
If we make one way, at least make it one way with the traffic, so at least we can walk.
Footpaths will make them clear.
No,
near the ISKCON.
On the road, we have given up walking on the footpath.
But hopefully you will see some change in the footpaths.
Right, it has been. Yes, ma'am, we have got that. Yes, thank you. May we have the mic in front, please? Many hands are going back and forth. I know, I can see that. Just a minute, please, over here. For a long time, the lady has been putting up her hand.
Thank you. Sir, you spoke about hawkers and the right to livelihood and that we should not be brutal. In every ward, there are municipal markets. I don't think in any ward the municipal markets are working. While there is development, if we thought about it like we, since we are comparing ourselves to many cities abroad, there are multi-level markets. There is provision for parking. If we thought about that and allowed that each and every municipal market becomes functional, I think at least 50% of the hawkers, we will be able to take them and pull. So my second question, sir, is that Juhu Beach, every year during the monsoons, has got plastic which is 2 inches thick. And we walk only over plastic. All the sewage of the city washes out there. Can we do something, sir, about that?
Yeah. So, I'll answer the first question. I'm going to ask you to put up the second film. It's just 90 seconds. We need to see that. Your first question was regarding the
markets. Thanks
for that's the solution. So we have more than 50 markets.
Yes.
These markets are partly dilapidated, partly underutilized, or
yes,
badly used.
Yes.
We have now completely reformulated the market policy. The aim of the market policy is to get as many of the street side vendors,
correct,
and the road widening displaces inside them.
Yes.
And we are doing it almost concessionally or almost at a free cost. The problem that they have is that customers only buy on the ground floor and they don't buy on the first or second floor. For that also, I am thinking that finally, if it's about livelihood, if they were selling vegetables on the footpath, you know, we buy our shoes in air-conditioned shops everywhere, but we buy our sabji on the footpath. There's economics behind it that while that poor farmer and that whole value chain doesn't have so much investability that air-conditioned good market gets created, which creates value for everyone, but the shoe manufacturer does have that, let's say. We need to shift that. So one way to shift that is that we are going to allow multiple things to be sold by the displaces. We are stuck in the following thing, that suppose we give the market for, let's say, vegetable vending. Then his vegetable vending is not running well, and people on the footpath are selling it much better.
Yeah.
So what the poor guy is saying, please let me sell telephones, let me sell telephone chargers. Now initially we said, okay, let's sell. But slowly he becomes completely only a telephone vendor because his bhaji doesn't sell. And then all our bhaji goes on the footpath, where at zero cost, of course, cost to all of you, which is that the footpath gets disturbed, you're getting very cheap vegetables. So this is a scissor action. One side of the scissors, you told me that we need to make our markets better, which we are working on. It takes time. Other part of the scissors is all of you. If you refuse to buy, at least where there are municipal markets from the people who are on the hawkers, then how will the hawkers survive? We need to work on both.
Right.
It's not one-sided.
Right.
On both the waste and on that, it can come. Okay.
So we will bring in the film later. Just a minute, please. Please don't appropriate the mic till I tell you to. That is not quite proper. And I'm really going to request you, time is short. Please keep your questions crisp. You are most welcome to give the question subsequently, which again we will on pass to Mr. Pardeshi. Yes, please, can we have the mic this side?
Hello. Hello. Good evening, sir. Pardeshi, sir. Good evening, madam. I am from Mahakali ALM, Mr. Upadhyay. Just now, madam, talk about the encroachment of the footpath.
By the way, sorry, sir. Sorry, madam. If a question has already been asked, or at least the issue has been flagged, ma'am, may I request that keep your question separately? Otherwise, we will be answering the same thing.
Ma'am,
it's issue-based. Please, so ma'am, please keep that in mind.
Madam, there is one open space is there, which was meant for the... It was a green belt. It was meant for the hawkers. It has been occupied by the builders. And it is supposed to be given to the hawkers. Where the hawkers will go? They have occupied the footpath.
Please keep the mic up.
They have occupied the footpath. Our senior citizens, our school-going children, they can't,
yeah,
they
yeah,
can't
yeah.
walk freely.
Yeah, but I'll take note of this Mahakali issue. Let me see. I'll just take it up with our ward officer.
Because
how we can shift them back and take out that.
Very difficult, sir.
Mr. Pardeshi, those who are ALM members present here, I think since the ALM scheme is being revived in the true spirit,
yes.
and in many places it has,
yeah.
it would be profitable for the ALMs to coordinate with their ward office,
yes,
on these issues.
We have told them
and
that. Yeah.
This is already, yes, now this is a live, just a minute, sir. This is a live broadcast. People are seeing it.
Yes.
And all the assistant commissioners are aware of this social sanchar.
Yes.
So all ALMs, whether they thought they were defunct or not, it doesn't matter. It's revived now. So all ALMs should actually now start working with their ward offices. And if there are any contentious issues, it can come to your level.
Okay.
So if that's okay with you, maybe
yes,
you could
we'll
share this with
yes.
everyone.
Yeah.
Yes? Thank you. I'm requesting again, please take up an issue which has not been flagged. I can see four hands going up. May we have, no, just a minute, sir. May we have the mic this side, please? The gentleman who had already stood up.
I can pass on one more.
No.
I want to draw your attention to the footover bridge at King Circle, which is not functional, and the roads are barricaded. So it's creating a lot of trouble to circumvent.
Take note of it.
Yes, please. Can you give the mic in front, please?
Good evening, sir. I don't have a complaint. I don't have anything. I just want a suggestion. Can we have a policy for avenue trees, for selection of avenue trees along that? Now, in front of this Malkani house, on the avenue are cannonball trees. So cannon fall and damage this. Now, I have been planting trees, I've planted over 1,000 trees in my area, myself. I have selected trees where the leaves don't fall or the branches don't go and they have to be cut every year,
yes.
so the BSC buses can pass through, etc. We could have that kind of policy.
Definitely.
Royal palms, Supari palms, there are a couple of, I have a list, and I'm fully aware that we must plant ethnic trees. There are 14 of them, as recommended by the department. If we can have that policy,
we'll do that.
Help.
Just keep in mind though that royal palm, the leaves, when they're dry, they fall down heavily and they can
the
break
branch.
A head. They're so dangerous.
But you can see them falling in advance.
You can.
The municipality can
It's
pluck
a very
them.
Big one. Yeah, of course. Yeah.
I think taking on from this, our horticulture departments of the ward offices are very competent. Perhaps such lists should be there and citizens can access it.
Definitely.
Yes. Maybe have the mic this side, please. The gentleman seated.
I got a suggestion for the footpath where the hawkers are dwelling.
No, we will not take up any more. No, sorry, sir.
Photo.
No. Issues which we have taken up.
This is a solution.
No, if it is a solution, please write it down and give it to Mr. Pardeshi.
I got a photo with me. I can show you just now.
Please send it across to... Please, sir, do not cross that line. Please send it. You send it on
the
number which is there. Maybe have the mic this side, please, to Ms. Karkaria, please. The mic to Ms. Karkaria, please.
I'll pass on my mic.
Mr. Pardeshi, I just wanted to know whether the Municipal Corporation has made any kind of assessment of the development which is on the eastern side of the city. I don't think it has, because there is absolutely no infrastructure that is helping people to move from east to west. Everything is happening on the western side. And okay, that's one question.
Oh, that's good. See, you have the east-west metro line, and all the new metros, not the ones which is underground, that is the spinal metro, but the metro 4, 5, 6, which finally go to Thane also, they cover the eastern side better, and then they connect back to Thane. So hopefully the metro lines will be providing better mass transit. It's not planned in that? Okay, I'll again re-verify. But the metro is now doing a whole circle. It's a whole circle of east-west now. Not the metro 3, which goes north-south. The 5-6?
Yeah.
Okay.
I must also tell you that Ms. Kakaria initiated her ALM in Shri, the first one. So she's an F-South ward. So that's how we will be able to strengthen.
I have a question. So are the ward officers now coordinating with your ALM meetings or not so much? No, I'm first asking her.
Yeah, Mrs. Shirsagar is...
1 minute, please. Yeah, yeah. We need the mic.
Yeah.
We need to have all the answers.
The best way to answer questions is to ask questions.
Yes. So Mrs. Shirsagar is there, and I think she's doing a Herculean task in trying to remove hawkers, because where we live on TJ Road, it is unwalkable. And a reason, I mean, I'm not concerned about a small road like ours, but the main thoroughfare, Acharya Dhonde Marg, where the metro, the monorail is going, it has occupied half the carriageway and no pavement is available there. So that was really the second supplementary thing that I wanted to say, that at least where the monorail has swallowed up a large part of the carriageway, please ensure pavement and no parking, because that is the road with 5 hospitals.
As long as you support us in the petition of this slightly draconian measure.
Mrs. Shirsagar is doing a great deal. Previous ward officers, I think with the best of intentions, you know, weren't able to do it. And you know what happens? It's really the question of a stitch in time. We have been complaining about one shop which was blocking the pathway to a very quick exit onto DeMello Road. But nothing happened. They told us he was illegal, that he had been served notice, they would wait for the monsoon. Nothing happened over 4 ward officers, and now there are 7 shops behind him. So it's going to be
so we'll remove that, yeah. That part will take action, especially permanent
shops.
So here
goes, the ALMs have to become strong.
But we'll also ask the ward officers to step up.
She's okay. She's very good.
I think some Twitter question then can we take up? I think it is one of the things that is being talked about is construction of speed breakers. I think that's one which came up.
Yeah, there was a huge criticism on the standards. So now we have a STAC, which is the Standing Technical Advisory Committee on Roads, which includes IIT Mumbai and Roorkee leading professors. So we are going to redesign some of these ad hoc speed breakers. You know, they're made with a lot of angst. Local people, because of an accident or something, make it as vicious as possible, but it end up doing both damage. So there are now standards how the speed breaker should be. It's both, it should stop the traffic, but also it should not break the car or create an accident. So some speed breakers are being re-engineered for
Thank
that.
Thank you.
Good evening, yes, everybody. I am referring to effective separation of dry and wet waste. We must provide second dustbin to all the houses and offices. They already have one, but they store dry and wet together. They don't have the habit of separating dry and wet. So if the municipality can provide second dustbin, or maybe through society or at cost or whatever it is, they must be forced to separately store dry and wet plastic and all that. And the plastic waste and all
Sir,
that.
Sir, your question. But, yeah. Your question. What is the question?
I'm suggesting for dry waste management. So if the dustbins are provided, then the waste will be separated and the sweeper must be asked to sell the dry waste in the nearby scrap dealer. Oh, municipality ko jana hai nahi chahiye. I've done this myself. I've been instrumental in getting dustbins. I'm from G-North Ward.
Sir, what is the question here? Is there a question?
It's a suggestion, it's not a question.
It's a good suggestion. Good suggestion. Only thing is, whenever you ask something from the general kitty, you know, if you ask from the municipal budget, it is everybody's money. When you ask something personal for something, it's like when you are in a cooperative society, you say you'll use the general money of cooperative society to make my window garden a little bit better. So it's bit not fair because we should do it. We are trying to do that for the slum dwellers, for example. We are trying to provide them separate bins and all. But house owners should provide their own double because
society
it's something.
Provide,
well, it doesn't come free. It comes at the cost of the municipal budget somewhere.
It's, I'm not asking BMC to provide free.
No, sir, that's
yeah,
enough.
Yeah, that's a good idea.
Yes. All societies and everyone take responsibility. No, sir, at the back. Yes, please.
I am Bhaskar Prabhu. I would like to just that you are going online for various license renewals, assessment tax. I do the lot of social audits of the websites, and I have brought some of the social audit lots in Meghalaya and Kerala and all these matters. So there is a right given in Right to Information Act in Section 2 to inspect the public works. I just saw the assessment, self-assessment website. It doesn't give the full detail of the self tax that will come to us. So if that detail is given, it will be very feasible for a person to get it, and the detail is not at all there.
Very good. In Pune, I had got this done. So Pune.
I know you got this done in Pune.
So we'll get it done here for sure that you can see your own tax in totality.
Yes, but at present it is not at all.
No.
So the reason, I inquired about it. The reason is that you do not have the total items which can be taxed differently, which is not there. Between industrial and office, I think one is there.
That's a work in progress, but there you will see impact in the next 2 to 3 months.
Okay.
On tax and self-assessment and self-payment of tax, all of that stuff, next 2 to 3 months,
yes.
Absolutely.
The other point is that I was in RTA Technical Advisory Committee in the BMC,
yes.
Which was, the other is that still the work orders which we take out on the website, it doesn't get searched easily worldwide. If that is done, it will be much.
That's also a good suggestion.
Thank you.
The mic may please be given that side. Yes.
Yes,
I must tell you, I must introduce him as Mr. Nitin Vadwani. He works in partnership on the education sector of municipal schools, a subject which you are not able to.
I didn't say anything on education because of the time.
Yes, just take the mic up. I hope it's working. Yes.
Hello?
Yes.
Sir, as she mentioned, I have been interacting with all the additional municipal commissioner, joint municipal commissioner education, municipal schools and the municipal dispensaries, both are in shambles. I mean, I have monitored this over the last 10, 12 years. The budgets have kept on increasing, but the enrollment has gone down, the quality of education has gone down. Now, Delhi has shown the way. Delhi corporation schools, government schools are doing very good, providing good quality education, not only spending on infrastructure, but also good quality of education. In fact, the pass percentage has surpassed the private schools also. So, can we take some measures, sir, to work in the municipal corporation schools? Because I think the image has taken a very bad beating in the BMC schools. So, we are here to help the corporation and work together. But can we do something on this, sir?
Absolutely. Yeah. No, we are working a lot on schools. I mean, these are some of the things that you can see. I'll take half a minute because schools are very important. If all of you give us time, I had just blurred over this. No, you can just go back to the main thing. So, you know, we have 3 lakh students who go to municipal schools. And the interesting thing is that if some of your children go to, let's say, a very good local school, maybe Cathedral or whatever, one of the very good schools, then our municipal school teachers get a salary which is twice to 3 times higher, which is not true, by the way, of my salary. My salary compared to any corporate would be 1/3, but that's not true for our, which is very good. Government school teachers are much better paid than almost all private schools. So that's one thing. So despite that, where we are missing is learning outcomes. So from class 1st to class 6th, what a child in class 3rd should know in terms of arithmetic, let's say 80% should know how to do multiplication of 2 into 3 types of thing, but only 30% of the kids know that. So we are not, there has been a lot of confusion in the way in which we assess government education. And for me, I have been after this sector for quite some time. I said only a single point, which is learning outcomes of kids, but learning outcomes of children not measured by school teachers. but by measured by independent institutions. So we have engaged Pratham. Pratham has done for all our 3 lakh students. That's first step. It's already done. It's going to happen every 2 months. Second, teachers get their salaries. They are permanent. We can't do a thing about them. Like me, all civil servants, you are saddled with them. You have made this system. Actually, I feel we should all be hired for 5 years at a time. And every 5 years, you decide whether to renew. But that's not the case. Neither for teachers, not for us. So what do we do? So what we do is, for each name teacher, you like a mirror, every month show him the performance of each child in maths thing. But if he thinks he's looking at this performance in the closed bathroom, he will not care anything. But we are showing him this in front of everyone. So the school management committee, which includes the parents, are going to see the same result. The local corporator is going to see the same result, and we are cross-comparing it. So we compared 50 teachers. 10 teachers are very good. All their kids are doing very good in maths. But then there are 50 teachers who do 30% of that. So then the third corollary for that is that those by name, you know, teaching is in our schools where maybe our children went, each person is known to the teacher and the child is mentioned by name. But in municipal schools, the class is a class. So they say, children, Bharat ka capital kya hai? Somebody say, Bharat ka capital Delhi hai. So they ask them like that. They don't ask, ki Ramesh, Bharat ka capital kya hai? Because they don't. So we are now changing that. Say, if a municipal school has 40 children, 40 names, and 40 names performance, and 40 names parents, and they get the result, and they sit in the committee, and they sit on the committee of the SMC, and we do this month after month, that is a lot of self-assessment for the teachers, compared to those who are doing well, because fortunately not all are bad, we have to pull the 40% who are the recalcitrant. So this process has worked, and we are doing this very hard. So hopefully our learning outcomes, as you'll see from the film, are not as bad as we think from outside. They're improving.
Thank you. So
no, they're much better. Structure is not the real issue. It's the teaching, the heart of the school teacher to convert what he or she knows.
See, when you talk about learning outcomes, what is the program for training of teachers? In fact, I'm also working with the CACR and all. We'll try to work out a dozen small ideas as to how, for instance, Akanksha is able to do much better. How, for instance, the other organizations like Muktangan is doing better.
So all of them are listed.
Yeah, all of them. So now what they're doing is they're islands of excellence in a CDO video critique. So what we can do is to present this certain specific action points, learning from these experiences, which can be replicated across the municipal schools.
Then I'm sure that about so what Akanksha does
20 or 30 years ago, municipal schools were considered to be good schools. They are not elite schools, but they are considered to be good schools. I am sure that we can do that if a few steps are taken, which don't require much of money, but it only requires a certain amount of systematic organization in this thing, then I think we can produce
results. That's absolutely a commitment idea.
We will sit and work out those ideas and give it to you also.
Absolutely.
Thank you. I think we have very limited time now. We'll have to wind up. 2 questions only. At the back, there was a lady who had taken, not you, sir. There's a lady who had the mic. Yes, please, ma'am.
Hello, sir. My question is regarding the building occupancy certificates. I would want to know why are they not directly issued online or on a counter in a BMC office. And I have a suggestion relating to this. So can we include the building occupancy certificate under the RTS Act?
So all of them are already, yes. Building occupation certificate today can be only taken online. You cannot, anybody who gives you a across the table building occupancy certificate is an illegal certificate. It's valid everywhere. Only building permission department gives occupation certificate. Occupation certificate today can be generated only through an online system. India was 180th. In ease of doing business. Now it is somewhere in the 70s. This travel from 180 to 70 has happened driven by the online process of construction permissions. But the good story stops here. This is all happening. I'm not just sort of thing. But all of us together made our minds to go onto the rules by which the buildings have to be made so complex that almost half the buildings that we build have some small lacunae which ensures that you are not entitled for a occupancy certificate. And that is where we are stuck. So there are different ways of building DCPR, building rules. Ours are so complex. Ours are three big books. So when a person has to sign off on your OC, he has to verify everything. I mean, fire compliance is the least of it, the sewerage system. There are many other smaller things. Somebody made a window and then the window got included from a flower pot into an extension. You can't get a building occupancy certificate. So things like that militate against giving the OC. So we are also trying to ease that and have an Abhay Yojana for that. But it's a bit complicated there because of the rules.
Thank you. Sir, everyone knows that the concreting of roads will prevent potholes. Why is it so slow? Because if you were to concrete the center of the roads and leave the sides for the asphalted roads for services, concreting is the answer.
Thank
in
you.
Bombay, it has been the answer for the last 50 years, but it's too slow.
So one very good thing about, I want to really, because it's very important what he said. So one is the certainty of the solution. I'm sorry, I'm going to ask all of you to just sit back and reflect for just half a minute. So the answer is so correct that by concreting, we can fix almost all the potholes. Perfect. So we have a problem, which is the potholes, rains, and we have a solution. And hey presto, why don't we do it? So I'm wanting to ask if anybody of you would just volunteer a reason why we wouldn't do. In fact, some of us are suggesting we should do the reverse, convert concrete roads into asphalt roads. Anybody can give us an example Marine Drive? Yeah, Marine Drive, we converted it. So please, let's say we all know this, including the municipal people know it. Still we did it or we are doing it. Just make one guess, please. Yes, we are a 24/7 city. None of you agree for us to close a road fully for 6 months. This is the time period we need to make it a perfect concrete road many times. We are coming with new technologies where 6-inch white tops can be done. But that is the main reason why it's a problem of a brownfield city where things are working but not working well. So you have to stop half well working things fully for a long period and then make it perfect. And everything is moving so much that it doesn't work out that well. So these are the issues. I've just told you the solution, the problem. The path from the solution to the problem is the difficult path. We need to bear with it.
Yes, please.
Yeah, my question is that when will my friend be able to get into the bus?
No, some of the recent buses are going to become those, they have the extension by which you can go on top of it. Our current buses don't have it, I'm sorry. But they have been included in the new electric buses that we are procuring. So these are all a work in progress. We can't change all 6,000 buses like that.
Actually, all the AC buses, they have that provision that they can be lowered and...
But we are working on that.
Wheelchair-ridden person can climb. The problem is, if we are on the bus stop, and the bus driver knows that we are there and we are waiting for the bus, he deliberately parks it at least 50 yards away from us, and otherwise he just drives past us. And this will happen.
We'll really take that up seriously. Yeah. A lot of people tell me that bus drivers are not that bad. They are quite kind-hearted and all that. But if they are doing that, of course, it's not very good.
Just a minute, please. Now, this is the last question. Yes, ma'am. I think many hands have gone up. I'm sorry. But we will have to close the session because this hall is required.
I'm going to ask you after the last question to bear with us. My story is my story. Anyway, I told you. You need to see something. It's a 90-second clip. Yeah. I really want you to see that. We're trying to build on those stories. That's part of our trust-building effort. None of it is lies. None of it is made-up filmy stuff. It's real thing. One of my rules to the people who made those films was shoot actual BMC people, staff, and actual BMC locations, and then tell the story. So there are two small stories, all of actual people. Have a look at them. Yeah.
Yes. Yes, ma'am, this is the last question. Where is the mic, please? Yes, the mic is on, ma'am. Just ask the question.
Yeah, when we talk about education, can we have civic education made compulsory in all our schools?
What compulsory?
Civic education.
It is compulsory.
Because most of our problem is because of lack of civic awareness.
It is compulsory.
There are many more things. You know, now we are moving on to things like better parenting. For us, because we have homes and time for our children. Think of people who work morning, evening and all sorts of occupations. They don't have place to sleep at night, leave aside parenting. So that's where some of the things we are working with Akanksha, for example. At least parenting for better education access. Are we done?
Yes, I think, I'm sorry, there are plenty of questions. May I please request all of you, you know the number, the SMS number, which is already mentioned in the invite. So please send in those questions. It's not that. It is not going to be put aside. All these questions which we will receive post this session also, in about 2 days from today, all these questions will be on pass to Mr. Pardeshi for him to reply. So we are closing the session. Sorry, ma'am, I will... just a minute, please. May we have the mic? This is the alternate, this is the cyclist. Yes, for our session.
The cyclist.
Yes.
So when it talked about advanced transportation and everything, there's always a problem and there's always a solution. I'm really thankful to Mr. Pardeshi, sir, that we had a problem regarding cycling and the cycle tracks for the city. Currently, we're working very closely to have a median cycle track along the Metro Line 1. So thanks. Thank you, sir. Thank you very much for...
I hope it materializes.
Yes, sir. Thank you very much. Yep.
Excellent. We need to close the session. There will be two films which will be shown.
90 seconds.
So, bear... Can it be shown now?
Yeah.
Okay, please have the two films on, please.
We are offline.
No. No. So, just bear with us for a few minutes, people in the audience. Just please be patient. We have a couple of formalities to complete. First of all, on all our behalf, I would like to extend a warm thank you to Mr. Pardeshi for being with us. But you have, you know, with the BMC being the BMC, we can't have only one session with you. This is just the precursor. So we want many more sessions with you. Yes. No, action taken will come along in its course. But there are so many questions. So from there, maybe we can have specific, sessions. And maybe you can also authorize any of your officers to interact. So all of us as citizens must get to know our BMC. And through the ward first. You know, it's not just the ALMs who have to work with the ward officers. But please, our portal supports the MCGM by giving out information, the same thing which you get on the website of the MCGM in a more simplified manner in some of the cases which are more questioned from us. We have put it up. So please get to know our BMC. Let's make friends with them. And then the question of making us work in partnership will be more fruitful. And I think empathy towards all of these issues is also something that we should look forward to. We have a few formalities that we need to complete. Thereafter, please wait for a short while and then you may join for refreshments. Please be seated. It's my humble request. Thank you. The trustees of VCAN may please join me.
Very sorry. Sorry. Captain Saurabh is not there. Huh? Mr. Kapadia.
He's not.
I'm sorry, Captain Kapadia had to go for a meeting, so he's not here. May I request the municipal commissioner with whom I started all this work 20 years ago, Mr. Ranganathan, to please present on all our behalf to the current municipal commissioner, Mr.
Kapadia.
Mr. Ranganathan was my boss in my first job as CEO of Amravati. And whenever he would visit Amravati, we would be really, really scared because he went into such details on the water supply problems.
We can.
A lot.
I'm going to take this opportunity, I think, from our yacht club. The president was here. The president of the yacht club was here, but there's a committee meeting, so they had to leave. So on their behalf, may I present a small memento from our club. A formal photograph, please.
A cup of coffee, anyone?
He's taking some pictures.
Okay, they want that. Thank you.
Thank you.
Thank you. Are the Jai Hind College students here? Please come forward. Jai Hind College students volunteer with us and they work on all our issues. They had requested for a formal photograph with you, Mr. Pardeshi.
Tell you one thing, I was noticing that you did all the work but you didn't hear the talk. So there was so much space here and here. And we are used to, you know, we travel. Yeah, but we could have accommodated them out here.